بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تبارك وتعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, all praise and thanks are due to Allah. We ask His help and forgiveness. And we seek refuge to Allah from the evil of our souls and our bad deeds. Whoever Allah guides, no one can lead him astray. And whoever Allah leads astray, no one can guide him. I bear witness that there is no God to be worshipped except Allah alone. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His last messenger and His servant, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who have believed, fear Allah as you should be feared, and never die except in the state of Islam in submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبَعْدُ رَوَى الْإِمَامَانِ الْبُخَارِيُّ وَمُسْلِمٌ فِي صَحِيحَيْهِمَا عن سيدنا أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه أن أبا اليسر كعب بن عمرو جاء إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا رسول الله أصبت حداً فأقمه علي، وحضرت الصلاة، فصلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصلى معه أبو اليسر. فلما قضى صلاته جاءه أبو اليسر وقال يا رسول الله أصبت حداً فأقم علي كتاب الله. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هل صليت معنا؟ قال نعم. قال قد غفر لك، عليه الصلاة والسلام. Dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, today we are talking about the mercy of Allah and His forgiveness, because we are in the month of mercy and forgiveness. In this situation, this short story, a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his name was Abu al-Yusri, it's his kunya, Abu al-Yusri Ka'ab ibn Amr radiallahu anhu, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have committed a sin liable of ordained punishment. I have done a mistake. And you can imagine that man, he came to the Prophet regretting his sin and confessing that he has committed a sin. And he asked Rasulullah to direct him for an expiation or to apply a penalty or a had. Actually, the scholars say he didn't commit a major sin. It was a minor sin. And we will know why now by the end of the hadith, inshaAllah. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, please execute punishment on me. What was his reaction, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when someone comes to you regretting his mistake? Imagine yourself, you're a teacher in a school, and a student came to you before the start of the class and said, oh, my teacher, I didn't do my homework. I didn't study my lesson. I didn't break my mushaf, and didn't bring my book, whatever. Whatever mistake he has done. And he came to you in private before the start of the class, like seeking your forgiveness. You may forget him. And he says that, so what would be your action? I think you will have mercy towards him and you will forgive him. Because he told you the truth. And he is shy, he don't want to tell others that he didn't do his homework. The same happened with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, but he did it another way. He's a special way, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. He didn't respond. He did respond. And then the time for a prayer came. The Prophet ﷺ prayed with the Sahaba and Abu al-Yusr joined them. After the prayer, Abu al-Yusr came again to him ﷺ. But the question here, why didn't he respond to him at the first time? Why didn't he respond ﷺ? The answer is clearly because when someone makes a mistake and he comes to you, you're supposed to give him a chance before punishing. If you're an employer or if your boss at work, you shouldn't punish people immediately when they do a mistake. If your children do a mistake, you are not supposed to punish them immediately after the first, second, or even tenth mistake. Just to give them a chance. That's what he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He didn't give back to him. But after the prayer, the man came again and said the same, Ya Rasulullah, I have committed a sin that requires a punishment. Please apply the rulings of the Book of Allah upon me. Then he asked him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and give him the glad tidings. Have you performed a prayer with us? فَقَالَ نَعَمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ I pray with you, yeah, I pray with you. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ Verily, Allah has forgiven you. Just like this, because you prayed. Because it wasn't a major sin. It wasn't a major sin. And we have, in many ahadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, الصلوات الخمس مكفرات لما بينهن. إذا اجتنبت الكبائر. The five daily prayers are expiation for whatever is done between them with the condition of avoiding major sins. So if you avoid major sins like fornication, like drinking alcohol, like killing somebody or stealing some money, if you avoid these major sins and you pray five times a day, you will be forgiven whatever you have done. And we have here another point to be discussed. That the admittance of the sins leads to having them forgiven by Allah. Like tonight, if you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at night, when you break your fast, or after breaking your fast, right, praying tarawih, asking, Ya Allah, I have done such a mistake, so please forgive me, and He will forgive you. Because of your regretting your mistake, you're confessing your mistake now. It wasn't a major sin because if it was a major sin, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام would apply the penalty upon him because he was the president of a real Islamic state, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had the ability to apply the hudud of Allah. It's a totally different case from what we have nowadays. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it wasn't a major sin, it was a minor sin. Rawal Imam Muslim fi sahihihi an Sayyidina Abi Hurairah, an Sayyidina Abi Musa, radiallahu anhu, an Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, Inna Allah yabsutu yadahu bil layli liyatuba musibu al-nahar. Wa yabsutu yadahu bil nahar liyatuba musibu al-layli. حتى تطلع الشمس من مغربها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stretches His hand in the morning for the people who committed sins at night so they may repent to Him and He will accept them. And He stretches His hand at night for the people who committed sins during the day so they may come back to Him and He will accept it. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until the sun rises from the west. It means until the day of resurrection. And here is how to believe in Allah's hands, in Allah's legs, in Allah's sighting, in Allah's hearing. We have ayat and hadith that mentions all of these attributes belonging to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can we believe in them? So if you ask your children, if you go back home and teach your children, and we should teach our children, they are our future. You may say, if I tell them about the sighting or the hearing of Allah or His hands, it won't benefit him in his life. But it will benefit him in the akhirah. If someone doesn't believe in Allah's attributes, he won't enter the Jannah. Because it's an aqidah. Anyways, you have to go back to teach him. If you ask him, does Allah have hands? He would say, no. No, he doesn't. Because he doesn't have knowledge. But if you tell him that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام mentioned that Allah has hands, he will believe in that. But you have to go to the next step. How to believe in Allah's hands? How to believe in Allah's legs? How to believe in Allah's sight and hearing? Say that. Allah ليس كمثله شيء. Nothing is similar to him. He has no equivalent. سبحانه وتعالى. طيب. Let's go to the next step. We are in the month of repentance for Allah. But before adding good deeds, before coming to the masjid, worshipping God, reciting the Quran, praying tarawih, you have to clean your heart first. But we have a qa'ida that ulama always mention, which is التخليق قبل التحليق. التخليق قبل التحليق. It means removing that bad deed that you have committed before adding some good deeds. And they have extracted this qaida from the verse that says, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى لَا انْفِصَامَ لَهَا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the disbelievers, if you want to convert to Islam, before converted, they have to clean their history first by repentance. فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ. So whoever disbelieves in الطَّاغُوت. And الطَّاغُوت is a name for anything that is worshipped instead of Allah. That is worshipped instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people worship fire. Some others worship idols. Some others worship the sun, the stars, animals. Whatever they worship, we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have our monotheism, alhamdulillah. But the first step before converting is to yakfur bil-tawud, is to believe in al-tawud, whatever is worshipped besides Allah. And then the second step, وَيُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ, and believes in Allah. So what will be the outcome? He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala has grasped the most trustworthy hold hand. The most trustworthy handhold with no break in it. فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى لَا انْفِصَامَ لَهَا. أَنَّ اللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. And Allah is hearing and knowing subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in Ramadan, if you eat something in a plate and you're done eating, and now your plate is not clean, so you have to clean it, right? But if you want to add some fresh food to this plate, before you wash it, you may get some diseases. Because bacteria may have in your plate, right? So you have to wash your plate very well first, and then to add the fresh food. The same before adding the ibadat during Ramadan, you have to make repentance, you have to clean, to wash your heart, to wash your history with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then to start adding the good deeds during Ramadan. That's the way how it goes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept all of us, inshaAllah ta'ala. روى الإمام مسلم أيضا عن سيدنا أبي موسى الأشعري أيضا. It's a very beautiful and simple hadith. Just one sentence. قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: يجيء يوم القيامة ناس من المسلمين بذنوب أمثال الجبال يغفرها الله. That's it. Just like this. Very easy to learn, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to forgive. He said that some Muslims will come on the day of resurrection with bad deeds as large, as huge as a mountain. What will happen? They will have mountains of lies, mountains of fornication, mountains of looking at haram things, mountains of hurting people, mountains of leaving the prayer. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. Because of what? Because He's Allah. Because He's the most merciful and He loves to forgive. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. But at the same time, on the other hand, we have some other kind of people that they will come with mountains of good deeds, but Allah will destroy all of them. He said, عليهم الصلاة والسلام, لأنهم كانوا إذا خلوا لمحارم الله انتهكوها. Because they used to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in private. When they are with people, they are worshippers, they are very good, they pray, they fast, they help others. But when they are at home, they are very mean towards their wives and their children. If you go to work and you smile at your boss's face just because you need to work, and I need my work, and everybody needs his job, right? So you have to smile and to be very nice. In the masjid, you have to be nicer, you have to be better than them. If you obey your brothers, your friends, because you love them, you have to be more obedient towards your parents. If you're very nice with people outside, in working places, you have to be nicer, you have to be better with your children and your own people. Otherwise, Allah may destroy your hasanat, because now you have two personalities. Thank you. رواه البخاري ومسلم عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال: سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يدنى المؤمن يوم القيامة من ربه حتى يضع ربنا عليه كنفه ثم يقرره بذنوبه فيقول: عبدي أتذكر ذنب كذا يوم كذا وكذا؟ فيقول: يا ربي أذكره. فيقول الله: فإني قد سترتها فإني قد سترتها عليك في الدنيا وأنا أغفرها لك اليوم. صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, a believer will be brought closer to his master, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the day of Qiyamah. And envelop him in his mercy. Allah will envelop him, Allah will cover, Allah will include him with his mercy. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, the word يَضَعُ رَبُّنَا عَلَيْهِ كَنَفًا. Allah will cover, will include, will envelop him in his mercy. And then Allah will make his slave confess his sins that he has committed in the dunya. Then he will say, my slave, do you remember this sin and this sin that you have committed? And the slave will say, yes, oh Allah, I remember. But he is now very shy. He is like, he is regretting his sin. He's confessing his sin, oh Allah, please forgive me. I remember what I have done because Allah reminded him subhanahu wa ta'ala. فيقول الله رب العالمين. Look at his mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala in that difficult situation that every one of us may be held accountable in the day of resurrection in the same situation, that difficult situation. فيقول الله عز وجل, I covered it up for you in this life of the world. In the dunya, no one knew about it. Only me. Closed your doors, you locked your doors very well, and you disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. وَهُوَ مَعْكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wherever you are. He sees you wherever you are and whatever you do. But nobody else knows, because he covered you in the dunya, and then he will say, and I forgive it for you today. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, just simply like this, because he's the most merciful. And then قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, then the record of his good deeds will be handed to him عليه الصلاة والسلام. So in this ahadith we can see the mercy of Allah during Ramadan. So repent to him, come back to Allah in repentance before worshiping him, so he may accept all of us. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله حمد الحمد والشكر له شكرا شكرا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم. In this story that I have mentioned, Allah سبحانه وتعالى said this sentence that we have to extract some lessons, take some lessons from this sentence. He said, I covered it up for you in the world, in the dunya, and I forgive it for you tonight, or I mean today. So from this sentence we have to take a lesson. That lesson we have to learn to cover each other's faults. Because all of us as Muslims, we're one thing, we're one nation. إِنَّ هَذِي أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. Remember yesterday I was coming for Taraweeh prayer, and mashallah had a big number of cars waiting for the prayer. Mashallah, Muslims love the masajid. And they have a brother, I had a brother that was coming with me. So then mashallah, we have a lot of cars, big number, alhamdulillah, that Muslims love the masajid. And if you go to any other masajid, you'll find it full. It's a very good scene. But he replied in a negative way. I will mention exactly what he has said. But he said, but they don't have good manners. I said, no, they have. You don't know them. They have good manners. You don't know. So you shouldn't be talking about your brothers because they are one thing. If you talk about your brothers in a bad way in front of others, who will defend us here? Who will defend us here? No one will defend us, right? So we are all one thing. We have to learn how to cover each other's faults, each other's mistakes. In the time of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, الحديث الذي يرويه أبو هريرة, أتي النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام برجل شريف. فقال اضربوه. A drunkard was brought to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. He drank alcohol. And you know, if you drink alcohol, or if he drinks alcohol, his punishment is to be lashed 40 lashes or 80 lashes. We have different opinions. 80 or 40. The Prophet ﷺ ordered the Sahaba to apply the penalty upon him. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr beat him. قال أبو هريرة فمنا الضارب بيده ومنا الضارب بنعله ومنا الضارب بثوبه. Some of us beat him with their hands. Some others beat him with their shoes. Some others beat him with their clothes. And then فلما انصرف بعض القوم قال بعضهم أخزاه الله. When some of the people left, some others said about that person, the drunker, they said, أخزاه الله, may Allah curse her. He's drinking, oh, may Allah curse him. فقال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام, see now, if you see someone doing something wrong, how to deal with that? You shouldn't go to everyone and talk about him from behind. I always mention that because we want to apply this. So he, صلى الله عليه وسلم, corrected them. He said, لا تقولوا هذا, لا تقولوا عونا للشيطان. Do not say that. Do not say Allah may Allah curse him, even if he has committed a major sin. Has drunk alcohol, but do not say that, and do not be a helper. Do not support the shaytan to overcome him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's how to deal with someone when he does something wrong. Just try to cover him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cover you in the day of resurrection. Because every one of us is a sinner, and we want others to cover us. We want Allah to cover us in the day of Qiyamah. So start by yourself in the dunya. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم وإني داع فأمن. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا. واستر عيوبنا. اللهم علمنا ما جهلنا. وانفعنا بما علمتنا. وزدنا يا ربنا علما. اللهم ألف بين قلوب المسلمين وأصلح ذات بينهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم انزع الغل والحقد من صدورنا. اللهم طهر صدورنا وصف نفوسنا واجعلنا سلما لإخواننا وهداة لأعدائنا. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أقم الصلاة.